Good afternoon, RSC people. It is week 27 on the Pre-Jump Podcast. On the desk tonight, you've got myself, Mr. Boss Radala, on the desk with us. We've got Rob, as always, Fusion Bleach joining us, first time ever. And Hut down there, residential small square, hanging out, running everything, as always. So, hello, everyone. How are you doing, guys?
Great.
I mean, I'm doing all right. If you look at Fusion down over there, he's looking... looking handsome with his name in front of his face, right? Big guy.
Just in case you weren't sure who he was.
It is me. It is me. I'm not an imposter.
Oh, I'm very quiet.
Not an imposter. Dude, I'm just glad they were able to fit you entirely in that box because, like, holy shit, I can't so fucking tall.
Okay, man. Okay. That's why it's going laterally, not like horizontally.
They had to do
box or like whole tall boxes just for me. I mean,
we did actually have to change the layout to fit your head in it. You're not wrong.
Did we really have to change?
Yeah,
the
you
layout?
Did. You had to send me different things today. I had to change it just so we could get Fusion Bleach in there.
Oh, that's right. I forgot. Not only is he the on the championship Brem team, he's also on the tallest player team in RSC.
Oh, easily.
Actually, yeah.
He's the captain of the tall player team.
On the team.
6'5" average. That is wild. Well, you know, we could sit here and rag on Bleach all day, but I think we'll go ahead and jump right into the first category here. Let's talk a little bit about Fusion. Let our viewers know. Most of you are going to know who Fusion is, but for those of you who don't know, Fusion, why don't you just get us kicked off here and let us know how long you've been in the league?
I've been in the league since Season 10. I've only played in Master and Prem, and yeah, I'm bad. I should be in, like, Veteran, probably. No, I'm not.
No, he shouldn't be in Veteran, because I'm trying to go to Vet next season, and I don't want to see him in that team.
Hey, team? Ooh. Let me just quickly pull up my ult. No, I'm joking.
That's a soft, oh, we that's don't a need sport subject for Master, yeah.
Already firing shots.
Yep.
Oh, God. Hud, I think your mic's actually muted.
It's on and off.
Nice. All right. Rob, you want to get us with a question here for Mr. Fusion, or you want me just to keep going at it?
Well, just if you had to sum up your time in RSC, tell us how you got here, right? Tell us where you are, who you are, how you got to be having a name tag that lights up in front of you. Walk us through the journey a little bit.
So originally my friend Brayden, he was in RSC in season 9. I honestly don't know how he got into the league, but he told me about the league and he said I should join, so I did. I didn't know anyone but him in the league, so when I joined I was completely new, completely fresh. Came in, was picked up super late in Master, didn't stay on the team because who's going to take a chance on a fresh guy. But I stuck around, played a lot of six-mans back in the day, and got onto teams because people started to recognize my name, started to recognize me in six-mans, started to just see my potential. The first person to really see that is Joe-san. So big props to him. I probably wouldn't be in this league without him because he was really the only person early in the day to take a chance on me. We made playoffs that season, so that was good. And met Snack Time through that, met Instant, met Slate, all people that I would later get better chances with. I also met Dr. Skim Milk, my current AGM. So yeah. Play six mans is the TLDR.
Play six mans is the moral of the story.
Yep.
I wish that we had your stats for six mans, but we don't. We just have your regular RSC stats. And I mean, over 4 total seasons that you've played according to the website, 179 games played, 98 and 81 over those 179 games, but you've still managed to win 2 championships. So it goes to show that maybe the numbers aren't all they are cracked up to be. All the, you know, the win loss. Master. That is over everything. That's total. Total stats.
I've played like 8 seasons.
I believe that. I believe that you've played in more than just 4 seasons. It's just the aggregate, whatever. It just says seasons played. It might be full seasons on the website, but.
Okay. Yeah. I'm confused about that because I've played a lot of full seasons and it's not.
So the website stats are wrong. That's what we can really glean from this.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Oh, blame Monty.
Yeah, I will blame Monty. He's my AGM. I will tell him to fix it once we're done.
Well, what I can pull up is there's a neat little sheet where I can pull up all your SPV and IDR for all of the seasons. So we'll pull up something like that and just see which seasons, you know, you seem to really pop off. I am curious, and I'm just going to ask you about them individually. So it seems like you had like above a 60 SPV and master for your first 4 seasons in the league, right? So clearly a continuously competitive player. And then it seems like you moved up to about a 50 to 60 in Prem. Do you think there's a season off in between the promotion, right? So do you think there was an improvement made in that off season? Was there an event or you started grinding a little bit more? Walk us through how you went from a low all-star player and master into a consistent prem starter.
So the season in between, so I believe that was season 14, was when I became AGM for Snack Time. I thought of myself as not a prem player at that time. I thought of myself as a carried master player. So I'm like, I can be the sub for a team. I was low enough MMR at that time. So I could have sat the bench, had my team carry me to a playoff spot. But I decided to sit back and focus on building the teams because it's also my first season of being an AGM. And I think that decision was well worth it because both the teams I built made semifinals. So that was good.
Grimmy wins?
No.
So, maybe not worth it, man. Rings live forever.
So no, that's the Snack Time curse right there. You can get your team to semifinals, but no further than that. So
I think you're just saying that, Rob, because you both got a ring, and I'm looking kind of bare over here on this hand, man.
Shout out Fusion, MCS legend.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's I've only played 2 seasons in that, so. I've won both, but
there you go.
I mean, yep,
that's all we need. Who? I would ask you a few more questions on the MCS side of things, but I don't know if that's the RSC.
Nah, man.
We're looking for.
No, we'll have to get like a different like weekly night where we just sit around and shoot shoot the shit for an hour.
I will say though, MCS has higher competition.
You see like 1900 average teams in MCS, and in RSC you see the highest you can go is like 1840 average, and that's if I mean, you can get that a lot of ways obviously, but like tier max being what 1930, whereas you have like is like Vanish and Comet are both like 2100, right?
So
yeah, I would say they're very good.
That's actually a really nifty thing to kind of segue into, because you know you play in Prem where we've seen it before with the cap space issues really restricting what kind of teams you can build together and what it all looks like. You guys really had probably one of the best well-rounded teams in Prem from everything we looked at. It really looked like everybody was contributing very equally across the board. Like you were obviously no slouch, Wolf was no slouch. What is it like going up against teams where, you've got somebody who's really top heavy, who might have all the mechs and skills that, you know, really back it up, but then they have 2 players who might be tier min and kind of really slow down the pace of play or maybe might not carry their weight?
So, yeah, I think you bring up a really good point. And I think this season and the prior season have been a really big change for Prem, because prior you could have a super good guy get you to playoffs and carry you through playoffs. But now you're kind of seeing the change from like, okay, this really good player can get you to playoffs, but once he plays a full, well-rounded team, he won't be able to 1v3 anymore. And it's this skill gap that's decreasing in Prem that's really interesting to see throughout my time here. I only think it's going to continue. The reason we did so good, obviously, was Wolf being super low and outperforming his MMR by a country mile.
I mean, what was he, like 20 MMR from Master? Maybe even less than that?
No, he was Tier Min. Or he was 5 from Tier Min. But Tier Min was, there's only 2 players.
Yeah, so. He's like 4 players off of being a Master player. And yes. That's just, that would have been, you would have seen a lot of records get broken in that tier, I think.
Yeah. He was part of a record-setting Master team a couple seasons ago.
But... I'm glad they got him out of there. So so that actually, the way that you're talking about those teams being built segues into a good question that I was thinking of. It seems like the real Prem Finals, or at least in my head, right? No disrespect to anybody in the tier, but I was thinking that it was going to be between Anti, Prada, and a third versus the three of you. And as you were just referencing how one or even two players can be just absolute monsters on the pitch, no pun intended, it can be countered fairly effectively. And so I know that series went 7, and I talked to Anti a decent amount, but I haven't actually talked to him about how the series went. Was there anything crazy about that series? Was that something in your head mentally? Like, I kind of am just interested in your thoughts on how that 7-game series against a team that good with top two that heavy feels.
So great question. I knew going into the season that was going to be our toughest competition, especially once Lyrics or Prada went over to that team. We actually played them the first match night that they had that complete team, and we 2-2'd, and that was our worst match. But we played amazing, right? So we knew we're probably going to have to play them. And when we played them, we need to play as good as we did match day 5, if not better. That was by far all of our biggest fears to play on, or me, Wolf,
so
and
that was the
biggest team
in your
to
head
fear.
Too.
Yes. It was totally the finals. Hurricanes were also a big question mark for us, but we didn't have to play them because Interstellar beat them. And Interstellar was more of a question mark because we played them match day 1, and they didn't have Cruncho, so it wasn't their complete team. And we never scrimmed them until the very end. So,
and Cruncho is a huge piece of that team, too.
Yes, very best player on that team, in my opinion. But that Anti Lurksing was by far the team that we were most scared to play. And I think we countered them very well. So, not to throw a stray at anyone, but I'm totally going to do it. Boog
I heard
not...
about that. That's
yeah,
the Boog... one thing that I heard about.
Boog is not a premier player yet. He is improving, but he is not a premier player yet. It normally takes a player a season to get from master to premier, to increase in the speed, to increase in the consistency. Yeah. Wolf had his year in Prem last season, and he did terribly, and this season he did amazing. Another player, Static, did pretty terribly his first season, and then did amazing his second season. And this is Boog's first season in Prem. I want to see how he does his second season, because I definitely think he's going to do better. But that was not a complete team, and we were. I think that was the difference.
Yeah. I heard 3 sub-100 point performances, and I think it's really hard. Like,
very misleading.
It's an incredibly difficult jump to make, and I think that's the point that you're getting at, right?
Yes.
It's obviously the hardest jump to make as the gets exponentially more difficult to go up the higher that you get. And so I think it's a really good point that you brought up, where people in their second seasons have that extra success, where that first season there's a really large adjustment period, is because there's no longer a top of the tier. It's not like you're playing within a 150 MMR range for sure. And even in most tiers, it's lower than that. You look at the top of Prem, and it's, 2050, 2100 borderline? And so the bottom of Prem is 1750. That is a 300
Christ.
To 400 MMR jump. And not only is it the gap of 2 tiers that are lower, but it's harder to bridge that gap because it's the best in the game.
To add on to that, too, this was one of Wolf's quotes a while ago. and it's really stuck with me. When you jump from the best player on your team to the worst player on your team, because that's what Boog did last season. He went from best season or best player to worst player. It's a different play style you need to play. Where if you're the best player, you need to be the one creating those chances for your teammates or scoring off your chances that you make, because your teammates aren't going to make as many chances for you. But when you're the worst player on your team, and I think Boog will agree that Yule's the worst player on his team, you don't need to create those chances. You need to be a consistent player. And that's the real difference that I see.
And consistent means something else too with that jump, right? So you can be, you don't get to Prem by not being quote unquote consistent, but when you have to do it as quickly as playing three 1900 players, right? It's no longer, oh, I'm faster than this GC2 who's playing in this league for fun, to this guy might be a bubble pro. And I have to outspeed them or not feel gapped by this dude who made a CRL LAN, right? Like, it's just a different level, and it's really difficult. So, like, but even getting to that point for Boog is really impressive too.
Yes.
Right? Making that jump and then going, losing to the highest winning percentage team in Premier history in seven games in the finals, like, it's about as good as you can ask for your first season in the top of the league.
And also, the snack time curse was still present. We were 0-7 in semis up until that point. So it was extra pressure on us to finally beat the curse. So if we would have played them in finals, I feel a bit less stressed than if we played them in semis, which we did.
Mm-hmm.
Which, I mean, that's just me, but it could be different for other people.
So speaking of just you, something that I was kind of curious about, right? So I just want to ask, because I don't know off the top of my head, did you AGM before this last season ever in the league?
Yes. So I AGM'd from season 14 to season 16. So three seasons.
Go ahead.
My job was basically to create the top two teams for Master and Prem and to coach the lower level tiers for the Syndicate.
So what brought you back into AGMing? Like, what was it? Just, Skim just hit you up and went, hey, man, I need you to come carry my Prem team? Or, like, how did that work out?
I'm not an AGM, so.
Didn't you AGM for Skim Milk?
No, not this season. It was Monty and Hand Grenade, I believe.
Oh, Hannon, that's right. That's right. My bad, man. I could have swore you were, like, either AGM or, like, looking to step up and... Oh, no. I know what I was thinking of. I was thinking of fucking Bosco, who went and became a GM.
Yeah. Yeah, but that does bring up a good side tangent I have. I was originally not really going to play this season until Skim hit me up and said, hey, would you like to play with Wolf? He's tier min, basically.
Yeah, what the hell?
Hey, do you want to come play with the best value in RSC?
Sure, I guess.
Yeah, I guess we could just come get a free chip. That's fine.
Yeah, no. It would have been even more broken. We were trying to get the first overall pick to sign Anti instead of Monster.
That actually would have been... Monster is absolutely no slouch, but like...
Yeah.
That would have been pretty messed up. Actually, that would have probably
would have been numbers reporting the shit out of you guys after the second week.
50 win team, probably, right?
Yeah. That's crazy. The thing is, our playstyles match very well together. Mm-hmm. Me, Monster, and Wolf. Where I'm not so confident our playstyles would have matched incredibly well, but with Anti, we would still be a championship team, I would say.
Yeah.
The skill would just be there.
Individual talent, like, all of you are bad. That's what you all are.
Let me see where we're sitting on time here, because as much as we'd probably like to be running it as the hour-long Fusion Bleach special, we do have quite a bit more of the league to really kind of get into if you guys are okay rolling into this next segment here.
I think that we could. There's no one better to kick it off than Fusion, as you were just talking about. Someone who could take us right into this, right? So, diamonds in the rough.
Diamonds in the rough.
So, for for those of you who are at home, sorry, Fusion, didn't mean to cut you off here, but I just want to kind of explain the category that way, because we've never really talked about this before on the podcast, so it's really new territory. For Diamonds in the Rough, we're going to be talking about kind of two types of players. We're talking about one type of player who grossly outperformed their MMR, and one type of player potentially who really outperformed their team's standings. So, you know, it could be a player who, you know, maybe his team is middle of the pack, but he just absolutely was the hard carry for the team. Or it could be the player that, like Wolf, for example, who was for some reason almost a master player again, but was almost top of prem in terms of, you know, RPV this season.
Yep. And with that, I can give you three names. One's kind of obvious. It's Wolf. I think it's for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
The second is Geherpaderp. He was on a non-playoff team, and I believe he had, what was it? It was something crazy, like, yeah, 82 SPV, which is top, like, three.
Yeah, I think it was top. I think Geherp ended with number one overall SPV of qualified candidates. Not RPV, but SPV, they were number one of people who played more than half the matches.
Yeah, definitely. So Geherp, and he wasn't on a playoff team, so... You can't even get MVP. The third person, Rob, you might know him well. It's Gavalanche. It is pretty low SPV. The difference is I kind of knew he was going to be good, even with his low SPV. Just
low cost, low sal. Yep. Not SPV.
Or yeah. Low MMR, definitely.
So yeah, I mean, reflecting Wolf perfectly, right? Wolf was essentially tier min and dropped a top five RPV or overall stat performance, instead of just using all these three-letter acronyms, was a top five statistical player in Premier this season. Gavalanche is, I believe, your likely MVP and master as 20 to 30 MMR above tier min. So with an 86 RPV, leading the tier in wins, led the finals in points, led the team to a championship. That's another example of somebody who really outperformed their salary, like we're looking to do here. Boss, do you got one you want to take us into?
So I was going to kind of go a different route. I was going to talk about one of the DEs, but I'm trying to get the contract sheet to pull up, and for some reason, it's just not loading on my end, so I can't check his general cost, because Dates was a DE.
Dates was a tier max, but yeah.
But he was a DE, and that's kind of, I was going to kind of get into that for more Diamonds in the Rough, because like with DEs, you can never really tell who's going to be that guy. But I think Chally this season, was Dalton FA or DE?
I'm not sure.
I guess, is there any way to see that? I mean, if it was low, that would probably be helpful, but.
I'm not sure. I have it already.
Let's see if it would hit. Because I could have swore a lot of the top end players from Chally this season were really some really fresh names that we haven't really seen before. Like, I don't remember, and I could be totally wrong. I could be off my rocker as an old man, really just not getting into it. But I don't remember D-Kami being in the league before. Dalton was an FA this season? Okay. Yeah, so I definitely could be just horribly uninformed about this, but I could have swore there were a lot of DEs out of Chally this season that really just grossly overperformed, and DEs are such a tough spot, because you like, normally with good talent, right, you acquire them in FA. You get them out of the pool, they don't really hit the draft, especially your really good performers, and then you're kind of scouring DEs for your fourth man or your third man, somebody you can plug and play, and hopefully they turn out to be decent. Hopefully they're not toxic or garbage. But there were quite a few this season in Chally that really just exploded onto the scene. And I guess that's kind of where I'm getting to.
Well, taking us from Chally to Rival, I think you have two kind of dark, not dark horses, Diamonds in the Rough on the same team with the Vikings. You have Kush W and Caustic Snow, putting up both top five RPVs in their conference in Lunar, and both of them are 1355 Sal, whereas Tier Max and Rivals 1410. So you have both of these players performing at an all-star borderline, almost MVP level, right? 75 RPV, 85 wins you it in Master. Coming out of this kind of average cost, right? And so that's a really impressive performance on a salary that didn't lead us to believe that would be happening. Fusion, you got any more for us?
I'm trying to find anyone. I kind of also saw it as people who kind of overperformed my expectations. So that can really only go in Prem, truthfully. I'm not looking at people in lower tiers and being like, oh, they're gonna suck. Yeah. They're terrible.
Prem question for you. So yeah. Lyrix or Prada, right, was about 70 MMR below tier max, but then ended with the top RPV of any Premier player this season. Did you know Lyrix before this season?
Yeah.
And was there an expectation of that in your mind?
Yeah, I've played him in different leagues, and he's always on the top level. Specifically in frontline, he's doing very well. So I kind of knew he was going to do good, and he doesn't play ranked much, and when he does play ranked, he trolls with anti.
Yeah, yeah. So the MMR might not be there, but the skill level is.
Yeah. So I knew he was going to do that well. Maybe not top of Premier well, but definitely like top 5, top 10 type player.
Oh,
for sure. But specifically the one person I did not see doing that well was Wicked. He really surprised me this season. He was on Interstellar. He made finals with Cruncho and Infinite. Cruncho and Infinite are good players, right? But it was really Wicked and Cruncho kind of carrying that team. They beat, I believe, Viperfish, which was Ghosty, T-Dot, and Goobs in 3, then beat Hurricanes in 4, which, I'm going to be honest, if they play that series 9 more times, they don't beat Hurricanes in 4 again.
Interesting. So they kind of peaked with it.
Yeah. Evil also played pretty bad. Yeah, from what I heard, that Hurricanes team kind of dropped the ball in semis.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to also reference chat right now, because they're giving some good recommendations for this, right? First of all, Ari cannot be overstated. They were a mid-season, mid-Sal prospect promo that ended up with I believe it was a 65 around their RPV in Challenger. And had a lot of wins. So Ari ended up with a 74 RPV going 34 and 18 in a tier above where they were placed. Right, so really not enough can be said about that stepping up. They were also in a great environment. They were teaming with a couple players that they know very well. And so this is another great example of how having a group of 3, like you were mentioning earlier, Fusion, can really let a team function at a higher level, because it almost doesn't matter as much about individual skill. Not that it's not here, but this team was made up of a 55 RPV Chally player and then 2 prospect promos. And they were a top 5 team all season because they play well together, they enjoy playing together, they grind, and it's really cool to see that exemplified through players like this. Also, Red Steel in chat was, they were a part of that Hammerheads team last season. They ended up getting double promoed, has a 77 RPV through 38 games in Elite. 22 and 16 record, so great stats. Not quite leading to the wins, but I mean, for a rival double promo, that is still very, very impressive. So it'll be cool to see what they can do next season in that tier too.
So what you're saying is they definitely should have been rival last season.
I'm
yes,
something like that.
Oh my god, dude!
No, well, numbers is a hard job. We can laugh at
people. Just
I think usually I love to rip numbers more than anybody else.
But like they get, I would say 95% of the players right, and that's
especially this season was really, really, really well done for them. So I would like to give them their flowers on that.
Yeah, we always laugh at the few outliers, but we never. Mm-hmm. Never give them credit for the other 95%.
I mean, there was no, like, 55-win team this season, right? Like, last season you had two in the same franchise. And so it's cool to see a lot more parity throughout the league, barring maybe Premier, right? Whatever.
And contender.
Well, yeah. But, yeah. Same, but overall, it was an incredible job for numbers all season. I'd also like to give a shout-out to a prospect player, Biscuit King. Their salary was prospect Chally. Sorry, at 12.35 was mid tier, and they had a 83 RPV, right? So middle of the tier, popping off with all star numbers again. That's exactly what we're looking for on these really, really good teams. We have to have that third player. Like, the lower salaries have to step up, as you saw with Wolf, as you saw with Gavalanche, as you see with Biscuit, as you saw with Ari, right? Every team that's performing at a really high level has someone overperforming their salary, and Biscuit King did the same thing, just putting up a bunch of stats as a mid-salary player.
Yeah, it's finding those underrated players, not necessarily the best players, but the underrated ones.
Yeah.
And I've got a question here to pose to the group at large as we're talking about the importance of being able to draft and find those players that are underrated, and especially as we talk about two tiers in specific, Premier and Contender. How important is it as a GM and as a, you know, somebody trying to build a successful franchise to scout effectively? Like, what do you think the importance of scouting effectively is in building a successful team, especially in those two tiers?
Well, I guess I'll start. Premier, I'm gonna be honest, you kind of have to know the players, right? It's not necessarily just like hold a bunch of tryouts, pick the best guy and run it. It's more, you know the players, you know them personally, you know you've played against them, you know their tendencies, and you try to build a team that can fit cap A, because that's the hardest thing. Is it's easy to find three good players, but it's hard to find three good players that fit cap
and will show up and want to play with each other and will care about RSC because it's not a paid league. And Premier is probably the hardest team to actually build.
That's why you gotta like know the players, and you don't plug in place. You build a team with a set goal in mind. And I don't think most GMs do that. They just see like, oh, this guy's good, plug him in, and then plug him in with two other people. And most of the time, if one cog falls out of place, the whole team fails. So it's really tough, unless if you have a set goal in mind.
And that's where I'm kind of glad you said Premier and Contender, because those are two vastly different tiers in terms of recruitment. Because like Fusion Bleach said, you already know most of the commodities. You already understand who's in the tier, what they're going to play like, and who they're probably going to pair well together. And Tendi is just a cluster, because you don't know, you know, that could be that AMI player coming up like Raichu this season, drop like a 70 RPV. You don't know who's going to come up and then immediately be great, who's going to drop down a tier like Slolo for Chally to prospect look absolutely insane. You don't know who's going to regain, who's going to mesh well, and who's going to pop off. It's a total shot in the dark. So for Tendi, you need to be running almost sometimes two scouts a night. You got to be running multiple lobbies just trying to figure out, you know, who plays well with who, who's going to develop, who's got the mentality to win. And it's such a tough tier to work with.
Yeah, and then my turn now, Rob, my turn. The thing about a Contender that I've always noticed as my favorite tier from my past RSC managerial experience is that if you manage to pull a couple of guys who they don't necessarily have to be the flashiest, they don't have to be the most, they don't have to be the player that you sit down in the Contender combine and be like, wow, I can't believe they're in Contender. But what they have to do is they have to show you that they're willing to learn and that they have willing to grow, because I think, and this comes back to my favorite part about RSC in general, is that it's such a great opportunity for players to learn how to play this game differently than maybe they would if they'd never joined. you find contender players who you teach how to rotate, and then they win championships. Like, it just comes down, it's as easy as that. I've won two contender championships just from teaching contender players how to rotate. And these days, maybe it's not as much of a slap in the face because the contender players aren't diamond ones like they used to be. They know how to rotate a little bit more before they come into the league, but man, there's nothing better than pulling together a group of like mid-tier players, showing them the way, and then watching them dismantle a tier.
That is a very interesting point, because then you have to like get three mid-level players that are willing to learn, are willing to improve. That doesn't really happen in Prem, where you're not going to improve by season's end, really. So you just get the three best players you can that want to play together.
And when you say, this is my major point, you hit on at the very end, you said play together. When you're talking about contender, really prospect, kind of anything really below Chally, my number one thing I need to find is three players who want to play the game, right? Like, a lot of the time, if they have been committed to playing the game for a year, 2 years, and like actually trying to be good at it, they are probably not going to be in contender, right? And so it's about finding those players who really want to just put in hours. However much they want to learn, there's no frame of reference for what a rotation is supposed to do. There's no concept of a lot of these things. So trying to teach them, if you find the right mind and the right players, I 100% agree. That is a massive, massive advantage. But a lot of the time, in these lower tiers, all you got to do is find three people who will play the game more than the rest, right? And all of a sudden you have, oh, I've never really played. I just hop on for a couple hours after work and then I go to bed. And it's like, ah, I've never practiced before. There's custom training packs and like workshop maps. And so you see these players, not even through coaching, not even through advanced thinking about the game, but just by putting hours in together and having a common goal, take an unbelievable jump through one season. And I mean, look, Balto in chat right now mentions that he didn't know that Bacchus mod existed before RSC. And
I didn't know RLCS was a thing before. Yeah. I joined RSC. I had such a... I was one of those exactly. people that was literally just AI. I play some with some buddies, mm-hmm. and then I had this whole other world of what else exists that is capable with this, and then obviously you sit here and you talk to somebody who is, we've been playing this game, I'm assuming, Fusion Bleach, for the same amount of time, but the difference between me and you is that I've never been GC, and you have been a few times.
When did you start HUD?
On release. I've been playing since 2015. Nope. I've been playing this game for a long time.
I've been playing since 2018.
Yeah, so even worse. He's been playing since free to play.
You and me have been playing since the same time, because yes. we've been playing. Yeah.
How many hours you got, Fusion? In those,
not many.
Those 5 years.
Compared to Prem, not many. Only like 4K.
Only like 4K. That's still more than I actually have total, so.
For what it's worth, that's a pretty condensed 4K hours, because a lot of people in Prem that, like, yes, it's less, but let's say that you have 6K hours, but played for three more years, right? Like those two.
Yeah.
So I think it is a really impressive amount of time to hit that rank in. Absolutely. But I just, it's interesting always to ask people just how many hours they have and how they're spread, because it can lead to a lot of different stories about getting to where you are in Rocket League. Like Balto. Right? The dude you're just talking about who didn't know what Bacchus mod was, you see him, they join the league for one season, they figure out how to improve what playing the game is, and they have a 38 and 16 season with a 90 RPV. Right? So it's almost less about finding the dominating players and finding the ones who want to just have fun and want, like, it's a game at the end of the day, and you're only going to play it if you're enjoying it, so might as well find the guys who do.
Initially, when I started, I didn't know about Bacchus mod or ball chasing.
Average RSC joiner.
Yeah, I mean, I joined because of a friend, like I said. And I was just playing the game basically for fun. No real leagues, no real tournaments. Just playing for fun and getting better.
I actually started playing this game with my dad. Yeah, go ahead.
I was gonna say, do you mind if I throw out one more diamond in the rough before I keep us running into the stat check category?
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Cool. One last diamond in the rough. Ami player substituted in the finals, was picked up. BB comedian absolutely popped off and kind of helped steer that team towards the championship. Really came out of nowhere. I don't think anybody really knew of who he was, but I just want to point out that he's also getting invested in the league because he's not only joined media, gone through the coaching, gotten a little bit of heads up, but he's actually casted one of the finals already with HUD down below there, and he's getting some experience in, and I think he's going to be a good acquisition for the league.
Undoubtedly. He did a great job in his first ever casting performance, casting Premier and Master Finals, which is not an easy, like, that's the deepest of the deep end to be thrown into. And I didn't figure out or didn't realize that he had won the championship just literally the night before until today, until I'm putting everything together for broadcast. And I'm like, wow, B actually, like, I kind of took a shot at him afterwards because I was explaining to him my thought process of not maybe, you know, wanting to cast Premier Finals with an amateur player, but with an amateur champion, I would have never even opened my mouth and said any words to him. So apologies to B for that shot that I took at him.
It's fine.
But no, he absolutely, he was on it from the jump, and we got to see, obviously, great Master and Premier Finals there, and all the way through, but no, he was on the screws and crushed it, and super, super happy to have him as, you know, a new acquisition, like Boss said, and hopefully continue to add to the roster of people that want to contribute.
For sure, for sure. Well, I think that wraps up our Diamonds in the Rough category for the first time ever. You know, it was kind of new for us. We might have been a little rough around the edges, but I think we were cut pretty nicely, like a diamond.
Diamonds in the rough around the edges.
Uncut, rough, diamond. Oh, just make God. All of the puns at the same time.
Perfect. Oh, 100%. It's just one super pun before we transition into stat check. Once again, for those of you who haven't joined, or I guess who have joined us before and who've never seen this category before, we're going to be getting into stat check, where we're going to be talking a little bit about some of the really big stat outliers we've been seeing throughout the season, and how they've directly impacted the win-loss percentage, like whether or not it's been positive, negative, so on and so forth. If you guys don't mind, I'll go ahead and get us kicked off here. I think a really big one that everybody's been following this season has been Angels' demo record. You know, they broke it by week 8. They had 188 by week 8, and then they finished at like 276. Which is nuts, right? Like, they broke the record by almost 100. But I don't know if it directly translated to the win column.
What was the record that they ended up with?
I think it was 276. Let me pull it up.
No. Well, like, wins. Like, what were the wins? What?
Oh, the wins. I think they were, like, playoff scrapers by the end of the season. Let me see here. They would have been Grizzly Bear. No, they would have been, what was that? Monster Mash? Banshees? They were 31-33. They were just barely outside of the playoffs.
I mean, yeah. Like, I'm not going to lie. If you're getting 280 demos in 60 something games, you're probably going out of
average.
Yeah, you're probably going out of your way to do that a little bit much, and it's cool to be able to disrupt, right? But if you're going supersonic at the goalkeeper instead of being mid for a pass or playing support for a 50, right? Like, that's awesome, right? You are creating space, but it's very difficult to, if you're out of the play, ask your two teammates to capitalize on that. So that kind of tracks. That's about what I expected.
I'd also like to point out, every single time you go for a demo, the next one becomes less effective. So what I mean by this is, for offense, if you keep on going for the same play over and over and over and over again, the defense will catch on and start to play that instead of, let's say, playing a pass where they just go for a demo. Why play the pass, right? Just play the demo and just go early. So every time you have a super high statistic that doesn't really work out, it's probably because they're overusing it and need to diversify their offense or defense, whatever it is.
I think that's a really good point.
All right. Who do you guys been seeing that has either been drastically helping their team in a weird way stat-wise, or maybe hasn't been helping their team super well with stat-wise.
Actually, I've got a, I have a little bit of a, an addendum to talking about Angel in the demos real quick, because I saw in chat Irish saying about the play of the week, players of the week, and all that stuff being up. The season 18 like a total stats leaderboard has also been updated. In addition to having the most demos in the tier, Angel also has taken the most demos by one. It's close, but they've taken 85 in addition to dealing out 279. So
all trade demos.
Yeah. The,
yeah. What?
But I would be curious as to how much maybe that has an impact on the fact that the demos don't have as much of a positive effect on the win loss column, as they, you know, a lot of them maybe are traded demos. A lot of them are, or they're being sought out because they're so demo heavy. So other teams game plan to chase down the demos or something. You know, I think that's interesting, and definitely was not expecting to see them at the top of both of those lists. But then also Laban with the saves, I think, is another easy, an easy record that was broken that I think we can probably point the other way of was more positive than negative.
Well, I actually, I think that usually when save records, and I think that this also is one, if you have given up enough pressure to break a save record, it means you're doing something wrong. Yeah. It might not be individually, but as a team. So I know you mentioned pointing the other way. I actually think that this is still a pretty negative record to break. And maybe it's not negative for Laban themselves, but like as a team, that was either Laban is the only one back, or there's no midfield presence to contest the shot or stop it before it's happening. Yeah, I it is very impressive and very helpful to win the individual games. But once it goes on for that long at that high of a level, I think it is implicating. Nope, that's not
loss of control over the
Yeah, you're not really doing the right thing in the field at that point.
Well, we've seen that before in previous seasons with players like Riki. We fall in last season, season 17 in Rival. They were absolutely getting saves every week, and it wasn't translating to the win percentage. They were below actually 500 for most of the season.
Yeah.
But then that's why this season with Laban getting 142 and then being 40-20 in the games they've played is probably the scariest thing, right? Because you're right, you don't want to be taking a lot of shots, you don't want to be giving up a lot of pressure, you don't want to be losing the midfield, but people are going to look at that and go, oh, well, I can get that many saves and still win games, and like, this is an extreme outlier at the end of the day. Like, you traditionally, we would not want to be, I would not want to have 142 saves to get 40 wins.
I bet if Laban only had to have 120, they even would have had a better record, which is interesting probably, to say the least, right? Because then the upside of this team, if they were doing something that not correctly for that much of the season consistently, think about where the upside lies, right? And so it's leads to some interesting situations.
Yeah. Go ahead, Fusion Bleach. You look like you had a thought. Yeah.
I would generally agree with you that saves don't correlate to wins. In fact, they normally correlate to the opposite. But just looking at Laban's teammate stats, I'm not going to lie, they're not as good as I thought they'd be. Laguna is fine, right? 53 goals, 39 assists. For instance, for context, Laban has 72 goals and 43 assists. So it's like double his best teammate, I would say. A little less than double. But the other guy, the third guy, is Blaniak.
Yeah, Blaniak.
With 50 games played, he's only scored 31 goals, 33 assists, and 34 saves. So yeah. I think it's partly Laban just doing everything.
I think that is what we are seeing as well. Yeah, out of necessity.
Yeah.
And so I want to touch on Tech's point, actually, before we get too much further, Rob. In chat, he said that look at the top three teams in Rival, just because we're talking about Rival right now, and see what their save numbers are versus where they are in their records. So, obviously, the team that has the most is Laban's team, Mats Marauders. They have 292 saves of the team. They were 43-21. Next two closest teams after them in the save column was Cursed and Wind with 279 and 272 saves apiece. They were 39 and 24 and dead even 32 and 32 respectively. So not a huge spread, but definitely you can immediately start to see that trend the other way. And then as you go further down, the teams win losses get lower and lower. 26 and 38, 23 and 41 at 4 and 5.
For sure. Another person that's topping the RPV is Anti and Prem with 118 saves.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone else in Prem has over 100. Yeah.
If you look at the savior number, it's even crazier.
Yes. But the difference is they're not just saving, they're also contributing on offense. So Anti has 54 goals and 41 assists, where Laban had like 70 something goals and something assists. So I think if you're saving, that's fine, but you also have to translate it to offense.
I agree.
Yes.
So something on the completely opposite spectrum of this, if you look at Elite, you have this team, the Knights. They were 35 and 29, which is a good record. I think they're in playoffs, or at least made it. I'm not keeping up with everything. But so they were a pretty solid team. They had the second most points scored in all of RSC. They were top five, I believe, in goals scored as a team. They were right up there in the top of shots and assists. 189 goals, 146 assists, 297 saves, almost 600 shots on the season. That's like 8 shots a game, right? And what I find interesting is that they have this 35 and 29 record, which they have. There's a stat in RSC called total shots, which is the shots both you take and the other team takes, so the most shots in game. And the Knights led this in all of RSC by, I think, almost 100. Pixel Picassos were the second closest team, but they had 1,125 total shots in their lobbies over 64 games. So let's do a little bit of math. That is 17.6 shots per game split between the two teams. So even if they're taking 8 or 9 of those, they're conceding that too. So as we talk about the importance of the midfield, right, as we were talking about with Laban, here's another way that ignoring the midfield both on offense and defense can really affect those numbers. Because if you can even control it on one side of the ball just a little bit better, then, I mean, you're talking about, instead of a 35 and 29 record, you're talking about pushing deep into the top five of a tier.
Yes, I definitely agree with you. And for a good example, not to brag.
Oh, my God.
But.
The crooked capos.
The crooked capos, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
We actually had the most goals for in Prem and the least goals against. And I think that came down to our midfield pressure. We wouldn't concede very many shots, and we would constantly just keep on shooting until they would break. So for teams with abnormal stats, I would say to basically improve your midfield.
Okay, you guys also actually led all of RSC in points per game as a team.
Oh, okay.
So
as the premier champions, I would expect you to do that. Not to diminish that or anything, but I would expect
that.
That
is true. We do touch the ball a bit more than every other tier.
So if you guys don't mind, I do want to jump in real quick into the next spot here. So one of the stats that we obviously follow as casters and then as, guy coach in terms of Fusion Bleach's side here, is we follow assists, because teams that can assist and pass throughout the team can generate typically more offense and look a little bit more fluid, and they generally translate to wins. And I think one of the teams that realistically we have to talk about is that Dagon team in terms of the assist total. They were about 25 assists higher than the next contender team. They were in the same mix as vet teams, as elite teams in terms of assist totals. I mean, their starters all averaged about 40 assists across the board. Which I guess for me is kind of wild, right? Because you wouldn't expect that out of a Tendi team. I'm used to seeing that out of Rival or out of an elite team where they're starting to do more infield passing or looking for more opportunities to really make a two-step or three-step play
But seeing these Tendi players, I know Dagon's one of them, but seeing Tendi prospect players going out and saying, hey, I need to look for passes off the backboard or off the corner, it is refreshing to see as a caster, but also as a coach in this league for me personally.
I think it's terrifying, personally.
For sure. Yeah.
It's crazy. So as you bring that up, I look at the top teams overall in stats, and in assists per game, Dagon had 2.23. And that was on par with just about the top of anyone not in Premier. You have 2.33 with Azathoth. You have 2.54 with the Hurricanes Premier team. Capo's 2.38. So 2.3 seems to be like the top of the top. And you have, as you're saying, Dagon right there at 2.2. What's even crazier is below them, Nightfall and Amateur are at 2.1. And Sloth are right there at 1.98. So you are completely correct. The best teams, the ones that are making this massive gap between themselves and everyone else in the tier, are the ones that pass the ball the most. And all the way, calling it back to when Fusion Bleach was referencing how you need to, how he thinks that it's better to have the three as opposed to the two, like a full roster contributing, the assists are almost as good of a metric of any as to see how well a team is flowing and functioning. Correlates to wins very strongly.
For sure.
Well, fellas, are there any other impressive stats that you guys want to call out before we move on to a little bit of our finals preview here?
Last one is Nightfall leading all of RSC in goals per game. It's pretty cool. Amateur team. I get it, right? But like, it's you might expect it to happen in amateur, but that's the team that had that crazy assist numbers as well at the 2.1. So full team attack leading all of RSC in the offense, even in the lower tiers. It just says only good things about how the league will be moving forward. And the lower tiers seem to be in some good hands right now.
That's, I think, the last thing I want to leave us out on, talking about how the lower tiers continue to improve and the way that that is kind of like talking about the prospect players that now can pass the ball. When I joined this league in 2019 in season 4, I was also in prospect. And let me tell you, I was happy when I hit the ball. I didn't have air roll bound. I didn't have power slide bound. I had nothing. I was working with a camera shake on, brother. We're talking that was how far we've come now. The fact that I can sit there and watch the contender or the amateur finals and be blown away by the skill that exists even in the lowest tiers in this league compared to where it was when I joined. And granted, I'm you know, shouldn't be compared for, I've won All-Star in this league once. That's the best I've ever played. So definitely not the flashiest person out here, man, it's just that's what when I say it's scary, that's what I mean. To watch these lower tiers pop off the way they do these days, I just my jaw hits the floor every time.
I also
do you have any fusion before we kind of shift on over?
I also see Dagon had 3.25 goals per game and only 1.28 goals against per game, which is a goal per game difference ratio of basically two.
Just a few.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They could have won every single game by two, is what I'm
saying.
That
is so ridiculous. Yeah, well, 182 goals, 75 against.
Yep.
All right, go ahead.
No, my bad. Well, you know, that kind of wraps up finals, or not finals preview, stat check pretty well. Let's shift on over to finals preview and talk a little bit about these final four tiers. You know, we've got Chally, Rival, Vent, and Elite. I think the simplest way to do this without having this take forever and a half is for each tier, but I want all of you to really give me a who's going to win and why. And then we'll kind of keep the arguing to kind of a minimum so we can get out of here at a reasonable time.
Do we want to do just winners, or do we want to say who we think's making finals as well? Because a lot of these are in semis. Cool with whichever.
I don't know. I mean, that's going to be the difference, I guess.
It's only been an hour. Okay. It's only been an hour. We're good. Where are we starting? Let's start with Challenger. Start with Challenger.
We're starting with Chally. We're going to go Chally up.
I got to go with my 2's GM Mark and go with Pen A Patrol for Battalion. There's no reason. I just like Mark.
That's a quality reason.
Is Mayor back, I guess, is my question. Because I know they were out for personal reasons.
Oh, no, they won without him. They don't need him.
Ooh.
They did 4-3. That was their win in the semis to get themselves to the championships.
Tough, all right, I'm going to go Penny Patrol, and I think they gap. I'm not going to lie. We looked at stats before. We called a couple other people frauds or not. Think about it. Earlier in the season, and Penny Patrol right now is just cooking. They have an average team RPV of 66 across their four players. They've been number one team for them and Slice, right there, for just a bunch of carbs at the top. And, I mean, it's hard to pick against them. They have the resume, they have the numbers, they have the stats, they made it here. They won a 7-game series, meaning that they have the ice if they need it. Like, they check all the boxes. Nothing against the Toucans, but right now it looks like it's Penny Patrol's to take.
My pick is also with the Penny Patrol based on our stats or our save metric that we went on.
That's
before.
Crazy.
Penny Patrol has 169 saves on the season. The Toucans have almost 100 more, 244. So the team with less saves is going to win. I've decided.
Also, yeah, go ahead, boss.
For me personally, looking at it, like, they played Cryos, the third seed, and they went to the full 7 games. And I think this is that's why I asked the question, is Mayer going to be back? Because Mayer is no slouch whatsoever on the pitch, especially for Chally.
Chat says he's back, but not at 100%.
Okay. I was going to say, because Toucans are better than the Cryos were. And realistically, I think that could be an issue, because the Toucans bulldozed through the Havarti Hustlers. Like, I know the Havarti Hustlers aren't as good of competition. They're 34-26 as compared to Cryos being 36-24. It's a 2-game difference, but the Toucans steamrolled through that series, and I think they're poised to potentially have a really incredible upset here.
I like that.
I mean,
you spread the
desk. Getting hot at the right time, right? If there's any way to kind of counteract one team functioning higher and higher for the most of the season, it's by catching fire in your playoff run, and the Toucans might be doing just that right now.
Fair enough. All right, fellas, Rival, we are in kind of a different spot here. You know, obviously we've got semis that still need to be played. Fangtooths and Carrots, 7-5 versus and then on the Solar side we've got Blizzards and Necrotic Nerds, who are 1-2. So who do you guys see in the finals, and who do you guys think is going to win?
So before anything else, I would like to say that the Carrots were the number 5 seed by being the second team in their division behind Laban's team, whichever I seem to be blanking.
Lots of Marauders.
Yes, thank you. So they were a top 3 team in the entire tier, however, got the 5 seed. I would actually be picking Mots and Marauders for the title had they not had been eliminated for whatever reason. I do believe that when functioning at their normal capacity, that team is the best team in the tier. That said, they were the only team this season that were able to beat the Carrots in any individual series. That's why they...
biased.
Yeah, that's what everyone says. But I mean, 3 players above a 65 RPV, everyone can do it. Everyone's been contributing. And so you can say that I'm biased, but I have my reasons. And I have no problem picking against them. If Mots and Marauders were in this matchup, I would be picking against them straight up. I guarantee you, I'm not looking against the 3-1s both time that they took. But they haven't lost to anybody else, so how can I pick anyone else over them, you know?
Yeah.
I'm picking... I think it's the Blizzards. That's the team with Steady, right? Yeah, Steady was a player who I had my eyes on going into the season, and they have been good for quite some time, and they've dropped a 80 RPV leading the Blizzards, who are the number 1 team in Solar,
or yeah, in Solar, and I think it's gonna be Blizzards, Carrots. Carrots take it in seven games.
Think they get pushed.
I do think that it's a very, very, I think it's a lot closer than people think with the 1, 2, 5, and 7. I think all four teams can really, really compete at a high level.
I also think, and as much as I normally don't like to agree with Rob, at the end of the day, I think it's going to be Blizzards versus Carrots in the finals, and I think we can look back to match day 6 in Shelly, in Rival, which I know is a long time ago, don't get me wrong, but Blizzards versus Carrots already played. Carrots actually won that series 3-1, and neither team has really made a tremendous amount of like shifting in their lineup. They have a lot of their similar starters going on. And the Carrots, that 3-1 was not nearly as, I would have expected maybe a 2-2 or maybe like a little bit closer in favor, but like the Carrots won game 3 in that series 6-0. Like that was a total beatdown, and I do think that if the Carrots make it against the Blizzards, I think their play styles are going to align in favor of the Carrots getting a chip.
Once again, going off the team with the lowest amount of saves, my pick is with the Blizzards. They have the lowest saves from all four teams that remain in Rival.
Let's see. Heads, Carrots, Tails, Fangtooth. Oh, shit.
What a flip.
It's Heads, so it's Carrots.
Heads, Carrots.
Yep.
God did.
Heads, what was it? Blizzards, Tails, Necrotic Nurse. Heads, so it's Blizzards. And
God
heads,
did, I'm telling you. Come
heads,
on, man.
Blizzards,
you can't make
tails,
it up.
Tails, Carrots.
Yep, it's going to be Tails this time. God did.
It's Tails. So.
God did. Come on, man.
Yep.
Carrots in 7, man.
Carrots win easy. Free low.
Incredible. I think it's going to be...
They got the coin toss.
It's going to be Carrots in 5.
Sure. Carrots in 5 for their seeding.
Well, I think everybody's spoken, so I think that takes us right into Vet, actually.
Really quickly, Neutrino on the Carrots in chat is mentioning that the Blizzards are definitely the second hardest team to play behind the Mots Marauders in their opinion, and they think that it's going to be a difficult series as well.
Fair enough.
Then, yeah.
So my coin toss was unironically goated.
It was, yeah, it was my picks. I think it was great.
So going into Vent, we've got Possessed versus the Gouda Gangsters, 37-27 in the 7th seed. And then on the Lunar side, we've got the Sea Devils and the Makos. I'll just get this kicked off here. Sorry, Rob, if you don't mind, I'll just throw mine out there real quick. I'm going for the Rudy moment. I'm going for the Gouda Gangsters.
Really?
Currently, they were 12th coming out of regular season. They 3-2 the Blues. They 3-2 Singularity. They played really good teams. Blues were third overall in the tier, second in their conference. They were 42-22. And I think if you can beat teams like that, there's a good chance that you could potentially beat Possessed, who were 41-23. And maybe go ahead and squeak into the finals against, and I think it's going to be the Sea Devils. I don't see the Sea Devils losing to the Makos, but I think the Sea Devils take it. I think they go 4-2, they take the series, and they get that chip.
I mean, yeah, you're talking about three-headed monsters winning all the chips, right? It's been what we've mentioned for every tier so far being the deciding factor. You look at the Sea Devils, they are... I mean, the gap between them and third place in the tier is smaller than that third place in the tier and the 12th you were mentioning earlier. Larger. So they are 7 games ahead of third, and there's a 5-game drop-off from third to 12th. So they are clearly... I mean, they've been performing at this level the entire season. They have 3 players with at least a 62 SBV. Everyone is operating at a high level. It's they check all the boxes that you've been looking for. I agree that Sea Devils takes it. And I like the take that Gouda Gangsters, not Gouda, yeah, it is the Gouda Gangsters, pushes through
They've clearly been, I mean, winning two elimination games like that, it's hard to pick against a team that wins when they have to, man. And so, shout out them, and I'm excited to see. I hope we get that series, and it's made tight. A 12-game gap in the finals would be a lot of fun.
How dope would it be if a seventh seed actually takes the chip, though?
That'd be sick. Yeah, that'd be really cool.
I can go now. So I was looking up the history between the Sea Devils and Makos because they are in the same division. So obviously Sea Devils got the first seed and Makos got the fifth seed, which was first in like overall in their conference and then first in wild card. I saw the record between them and Sea Devils are up 7-1 basically. So that's exactly why I'm going with the Makos, because I believe in the underdog story. I have faith. I have faith. They're going to beat them four extra times than they did in eight games.
Oh my god.
It would be funny. It would be
Take. I like the take, man.
No one has faith in them. No one has faith in them. So I gotta have faith.
I got nothing to lose.
Garuda Gangsters Possessed. I'm going with Possessed here. Again, there's not much of a difference between these teams. The one thing I see is the Garuda Gangsters. They won in five both times. Where, like, they could have just peaked that day.
So did Possessed.
Yeah.
Which I didn't see as well.
Won in five. But both times. Believe they're both times?
Mm-hmm. Oh. They won 3-2 against Gorillas and then 3-2 against Water.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I was looking at the top one. The
3-1. Oh, yeah. Because of the reseeding.
Yep. Yeah. I still take Possessed, though. I don't have a very good reason.
They're the higher seed. I mean, yeah,
these are best of sevens, too. Winning a game five doesn't mean anything in a best of seven.
Yeah.
True.
So
I do think the Possessed Garuda Gangster series is going to be close, but I think Mako's taking five. I think it's gonna be really a shock.
Oh my god.
They're just gonna come out and have nothing to lose, and they're gonna
I like it.
And then it's a different match day, obviously, from semifinals to finals. I still think Makos take it though, but this one's gonna be a much closer series because they're much more stressed, because they beat the hard team, so they should beat up on this easy team. But they don't, so they get more stress.
They're going to overlook them, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, and then mine, to wrap it up, I think I can't pick Garuda Gangsters over Possessed. Of the four teams in Veteran, they have the lowest assist numbers, which now that I've had somebody else tell me that assists are more important than saves in chat, I've decided to change my tune. So, Garuda Gangsters are going to get bounced by Possessed on the Solar side. I'll go for the Makos over the Sea Devils, too. I like an underdog story just as much, and my heart remains with Shark Attack always. So, that gives us a 3v5 in the finals, Possessed v. Makos. Give it to Makos. I'll agree with Fusion Bleach. It's not a bad look.
Yeah.
Well, that wraps up Vet quite nicely, and that brings us into our final tier predictions for the night. We've got Elite, where on the Solar side, we're going to have the Pixel Picassos and the Cyclones, the 1 and 2. And on Lunar, we're going to have Azathoth and Gelato, 1 and 4. So for this one, Fusion, do you want to get us kicked off here?
Yeah, I'll get us kicked off. I actually know some of these players now, so it's going to be nice.
Yeah, the rest of us peasants, you know. Now that we're out of the way, now we can talk about the good teams, right?
Yeah. So Galato actually beat my franchise's Elite team in game 5 OT. So I gotta go with them over Azathoth. I don't know how to say that name. I know the players, not the team names.
Gelato?
Yeah.
Have you never had gelato in your entire life?
No, I haven't.
It's like Italian ice cream.
Okay, cool.
You should look into it, it's pretty great.
And then
they usually have it at
Picassos and Cyclones. I was looking at the stats, And when Cloudy is your worst player, worst statistical player on your team, that's kind of crazy.
Yeah, especially in Elite for that. Yeah. He, in my opinion, is... So you talk about Wolf being the best value in RSC. Yeah. Cloudy isn't putting up the stats, right? To be like, oh, top five RPV in the tier. But, dude, Cloudy being your third in terms of salary and production in Elite, like, from MCS, I know the dude's a dog. Yeah. I subbed up to a Chally lobby when I was Rising Star last season. He was also Rising Star. And dude just fit in. And so it's crazy.
Dude was running circles in like challenges.
Yeah. Yeah, he was. And so shout out to homie as well.
Yep. But, so yeah, I'm taking Pixel Picassos and let's give Cyclones a game. And it's going to be a sweep in finals.
Cyclones do have your likely elite MVP though. They have a player with 101 IDR. Avatar Mans.
No, I have faith in Noah. I have faith in Noah. He's going to take it. I got Noah 100%.
Noah is on the Ghastly Goombas.
Yes.
Which isn't one of those.
No, he's going to get MVP, though. Have trust.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Have I follow. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, Rob, what is going to be your prediction here?
I don't think that Fusion finishes finals.
I said Pixel Picasso sweep.
Yeah, 4-0.
In finals, I missed that. Yeah. So I think this is a really good top four for Elite. I think that as good as the top four is, you have these top two teams for a reason. I think that they are the two best teams in Elite. I think that the Cyclones or Gelato could win their individual series and even could win finals, right? But I do think that the Pixel Picassos take their series. It's best seven, probably in six or seven. Cyclones are good. They have a dude who's been producing at a really, really high level all season. 100 IDR or RPV in Elite is nothing to really scoff at. That's a really impressive number. But like you said, Pixel Picassos, Cloudy's the worst statistical player on that team. You have Fluffy. He actually just hit GC3 and twos like last week. And I mean, I don't know. That team's really good. But on the other side, I think Gelato has some good players, specifically Mew Jr. But I think that Azathoth, God, it pains me to say it, that they take it. I think it's pretty quick. I think you have three of the better players in Elite on that team. With DJ likewise and Greg, I think that you're looking at a very, very well-rounded group of three. And so maybe that one goes five or six, but I think Azathoth takes it. And then I think you're into a seven-game bloodbath of a series in the finals between Azathoth and Pixel Picassos. I think that this has the potential to be the best final. If this is what we get, I think it could be the best matchup that we see in all of RSC this season. I think you have three players who are really good. Six players who are really good. I think all of them could justifiably be like a fourth on a master team, even a third, depending on who they are. Everyone is a really, really solid player. Everyone has a 60 plus RPV. There are no weak spots for the tier. I think Pixel Picassos take it in seven, but I could see that going either way if some team catches fire or one lets the moment get to them. But I think Pixel Picassos and Azathoth would be... DJ has lost three finals in a row. But it might change. Fourth time the charm is what they say. But I do think that would be an absolutely sick game to watch. So Picassos in seven over Azathoth in the finals.
Hud, who do you have? And then I'll wrap us up shortly after.
I also have Azathoth over Pixel Picassos in the finals. I lied. Other way around. Pixel Picassos versus Azathoth in the finals. Pixel Picassos to win in the finals, though. I've picked Gold Differential to be my stat for this one, and they have plus 20 over the next closest, which is they have plus 85 on the season. Next closest, which is Azathoth, is plus 65, and that's a pretty big gap. So they're my pick. I won't say in seven, I'll say in six, 4-2.
Okay. Well, I'll wrap us up here for Elite, and I think, you know, clearly it's easy to talk about who's going to be in the finals. Like we've already mentioned, Pixel Picassos and Azathoth look like the Elite championship contenders that they are. The crazy thing is, when you look at it, they're 1-3 respectively in all of RSC
for goals. They're 1 and 2 in all of RSC for assists. They're insanely high on shots. So these are two high volume offensive teams that are going to be duking it out for the finals. And I think the winner, as shitty of a statement as this is going to be and as cringy as this is going to be, is RSC viewership, because this is going to be the biggest slugfest I think we're going to see in a final stream by far.
You think it's that? Are you thinking there's not really a chance for Cyclones or Gelato to come through and take it? You think it's these guys for sure?
I think if they do, I think there's always a chance, right? In RSC, yeah, there's always a chance that either something happens, somebody pops off, somebody's internet goes to shit. You never know. And if they do, it's going to be a massive storyline. Like if the Cyclones beat Pixel Picasso's on their side.
It's like what you saw in Rival this season.
Right. It would be massive. Like everybody's going to be like, holy cows, Cyclones just beat Pixel Picasso's. This is insane. It would be such an incredible thing to cast. It'd be like Azathoth last season when I was casting and we were trying to find out who the finals elite was going to be.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, holy Azathoth or the Buzzsaw. They just can't. But I think the final series is such a toss up, right? Because DJ has struggled in the finals. Old Man Greg has been your playoff performer in the finals. So like, it's such a weird, perplexing situation that I don't know who's going to be that team. I do want to shout out DJ because when Fusion Bleach said I need to be on the podcast and I said, bet, DJ's like, I need to be on the podcast. And they responded with a chip first.
DJ has been asking to be on the podcast since like before it started.
If DJ wins, if they get the chip, I'm saying it now, I'm getting him on the pod for an interview.
Oh my gosh. Does that mean that someone from the Picassos?
Get him on the podcast, have him answer like a question and then kick him.
And then just kick him off. Yeah. Just boot him from
the chair. Yeah. Barely 30 seconds.
We'll have to figure it out. But for sure, I know that man's been fucking begging to be on the podcast for a hot minute. And we gotta reward him at some point. He's been a loyal viewer, and I'm down.
Well, let's see if DJ responds within like 20 seconds in chat. We'll give it.
Imagine
to him.
DJ he's not here.
Yeah,
that'd be devastating.
This is on. We should get. Regardless, if those two teams are in finals, I agree with Dylon. If we got a Fluffy and DJ segment together for an interview, for if that's in the finals, that would be. That would be a lot of content. I think that would be an interesting one.
It'll be kind of tough. For those of you who are intending to watch next week, we are going to have a different cast than normal because next week is our end of season stream. So interview probably won't happen then for regardless who it is. But for sure, that is something we'll have to look at. Maybe next season going into preseason. Mm-hmm. Maybe that'll be something we look into.
But DJ not being here is crazy.
100%. But for those who also may or just want to shout out, saw you in the Twitch chat there, I am so glad to see you back for Monday, man. You are an absolute stud. But Rob, Fusion, HUD, anything you guys want to say before we wrap up this stream tonight?
It has come to my knowledge that I've taken the most demos in Prem this season, so.
You gotta get better at jumping.
Yeah, or just
being
aware.
And
the person behind me is Anti, so maybe they're just taking out the best players.
Oh, yeah.
That is crazy cope.
Fusion's over here like, I'm just better than Anti because I took more demos than
Anti. In the tier. People just
All I'm saying is the amount of flip resets Anti has hit on me in playoffs is 0, and I've hit 2 on him, so. All I'm saying.
Ooh, shots fired. Rob, do you have anything to wrap up this stream?
I'm second. I got more points per game than you in Prem, is all I'm saying. So you'd better hope you don't see me there.
Yeah, play another series and we'll see.
Yeah. All right, man. Don't worry about the games played.
Yeah. Everybody, make sure you watch the last two nights of the broadcast for the season. I will be involved with them in some way. Boss won't be because he has to be at work, but we're going to hold down the fort without him while he's gone. Make sure that you watch the last two because obviously we just broke them all down. They're all going to be bangers. So do that. show up next week for the end of season stream. That's it.
For sure, for sure. And, you know, on my end, I just want to point out Wednesday, match day 19. It's Rival versus Vet. It's going to be HUD and T-Sant casting. T-Sant, the GOAT, getting back on the mic. It's going to be such an absolute dub for the league. But I just want to shout out everybody in the season who's been super supportive of RSC, who's really jumped into the committees and really helped out. You know, we've got a lot of fresh blood that I'd love to see. Rob, BB Comedian, you know, you guys getting in and casting in the booth is such an absolute win. Love to see it all across the board. Next week, we're going to be doing the season ending stream here. So that's going to be the Pre-Jump Podcast and hopefully a few different people. I need to reach out to Fiend and see if we can get him on board. But
everybody look at Rob's pool.
For sure. For sure, I need to be getting this ending stream solid. Dyer's been making all the graphics for us, so you know this stream is going to be absolutely insane. For everybody who's tuned in, though, thanks for watching tonight. My name is Still Been Boss. We've had Fusion Bleach as a guest tonight. Rob, as always, and HUD producing. But for everybody who's tuned in, thank you. Have a good night.